RAND did not quite develop game theory, although its first and foremost advocate, von Neumann, worked at RAND for a number of years. And obviously John Nash, who's the most popular figure in game theory, also worked at RAND for a number of years. They didn't come up with it, but they certainly harbored it, and they certainly hired so many people who worked there during the heyday of game theory in the 1950s. Again, it all stems from the concept of reason and self-interest, that people, since people are following self-interest and people are only looking out for themselves, therefore it stands to reason that they would think in numerical concepts. They would think of life in quantitative terms, and that they would only be looking out for themselves. After all, game theory develops as a way of, again, trying to divine what others will do under unknown circumstances, and again, thinking that people are always self-interested actors. There's no such thing as altruism in game theory. And therefore, it becomes rational, so to speak, that if you have to give up your best friend because you're going to get an advantage, then you will do so. And if you have to turn your back on the doctrines that your country has always held dear, that you will do so as well, because you stand to gain. Obviously, people are not like that. And that's one of the things that RAND found out in the late 50s and early 60s. When dealing with people who refused to act as rational actors, namely the Viet Cong, that was like the first major experience that RAND had of people who were not rational, because rational theory held, well, you know, and it was what the U.S. government was doing in Vietnam at the time. We were saying, well, if we bomb them long and hard enough, they'll come to the bargaining table because they'll see we're going to wipe them out. They realized after a while it doesn't work, because these people believe in a cause greater than themselves. And therefore, with those people appealing to rational self-interest, doesn't work. You have to appeal to something else. Ultimately, RAND gave up on game theory as a prognosticator of human behavior because they realized that humans are much more than that. However, that didn't stop them from using that theory then to turn us all into consumers, knowing that they can appeal to that particular aspect of human nature, because after all, we do have that within ourselves. We do have self-interest. Obviously, you know, we have to look out for ourselves, but humans are much more than that. We believe in God. We believe in our country. We believe in helping others, even if we don't get anything out of it ourselves. And those are things that don't fit into that neat theory called rational choice. And it certainly doesn't fit into game theory. As you probably know, I was born in Cuba. And I was there in the early years of the communist revolution in that country. And I saw what they were trying to do. They were trying to turn people into different people, into what they call the new man. And thus, I know what an authoritarian and autocratic technocracy wants to do. And that's what they were trying to do back in Cuba. So when I first heard of RAND, I mean, I thought, oh, it's ridiculous. I mean, that can't exist. That can't happen in this country. And then I thought, well, you know, that's the figment of some pothead who's thinking, oh, you know, it's all these guys, we're all these going around, and they're creating all these monsters that don't exist. So when I approached RAND, I came in, you know, as somebody who had actually done some research on actual plots that had been authorized by real madmen, which is what Hitler was, because my previous book dealt with terrorists who have been authorized by Adolf Hitler to come to this country and start a wave of terror right after Pearl Harbor. And I came up to them and I asked them, you know, I'd like to do a book on you. I don't think anybody has really done anything on you. And, you know, I'd like to see what you're doing and, you know, what your contribution to American politics and to world history has been. Much to my surprise, they said, we'll do it. And, you know, we'll open up our archives to you. Our only proviso is that we ask that, you know, you tell us what it is that you're going to be dealing with, and that, you know, Not that you tell us what is it that you want to do. And I told him, I said, I want to look at everything. I want to see everything that you've done. I want to see the good and the bad. And they open up their archives. And, you know, I have nothing bad to say about them when it comes to that. I have nothing bad to say about them personally either. I think they're all, and this is the tragic part of it, they're all honorable men. But, you know, isn't that what they, what I think it was Mark Antony said, Julius Caesar? They're all honorable men. Be that as it may, they opened up their archives. And I went into it. And at the beginning, I thought, this can't be true. I mean, because I started seeing what they were doing. And I guess they were doing it with the best of intentions. After all, they do believe that reason is a good thing, that unbridled reason is an even better thing, which of course I totally disagree with. And once I saw what they were doing, I just had to come to my own conclusions. I do believe that RAND expected me to give him a pat on the back and say, that's the way to go, fellas. You know, I mean, good for you. Let's show him what people who believe in reason can do. But, you know, I mean, I was born in a country that tried to do that and went nowhere. And right now, it's one of the poorest countries in the world. You know, everybody's poor right now over there. It's a mess. And I've seen what happens when you have a small group of people that pretend to speak on behalf of the majority. And I just cannot accept that. I'm a real believer in democracy. I'm really grateful to this country for having given me a chance to grow up here and to see what democracy is all about. And to realize that, you know, it's really what those people back in the 60s were saying, only now I really believe in it, which is really power to the people. I mean, it's really the people of this country that really have to rise up and say, this is what we want to do. And we have to stop small groups of technocrats and self-appointed messiahs to come and tell us, this is what's good for you. And this is what you have to do. It's up to us to decide what our future is. It's up to the American people to decide what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. And I hope nobody ever forgets that. Otherwise, we run the risk of becoming another Cuba. Stay informed. You have to know things. You can't rely on somebody else coming and telling you, this is what's good for you. No, we have to go out and we have to do the research ourselves. You have to find out what is going on in this world. And who are the people who are really looking out for you? And who are the people who are really not acting in your best interests? An informed people is the best defense against tyranny. And I'm afraid that unless we continually keep that in front of us, unless we stay informed, unless we stay vigilant, as Thomas Jefferson warned us, that we'll be facing great danger in the years ahead. Now, one of the oddest things about rational choice is how it affects your medical care. Now, remember, rational choice means that you're looking out for self-interest, right? You're looking out for yourself, right? Now, what people don't realize is that medical plans up until the 1970s, approximately, pay for everything. There were no deductibles. What you and I pay as deductibles right now came out of something called the RAND medical experiment. President Nixon wanted to cut back on the amount of money that the federal government was spending on Medicare. So therefore, it authorized RAND to conduct an experiment. And it did so with tens of thousands of people, whereby they were offered certain kinds of medical treatment and medical benefits, and others were not, depending on how much people were going to use them. It turned out that most people did not really want to use all the benefits to which they were entitled, and that apparently people did not object when they had to pay a small sum for the deductible. And seeing that people did not object and that they were going to be getting more or less the same kind of treatment and the same kind of benefits, the federal government decided, well, from now on, I guess we'll just impose a deductible on Medicare on all the medical benefits that we offer. When the federal government started doing that, first in certain select localities and then throughout the country, private practice, private industry looked at it and said, hey, if they're doing it, we can do it now. So then deductibles began very small at first. I don't know if people will remember that, but and it used to be just a few dollars. But now it then started increasing and increasing and increasing until at the end it became almost like the employee was mostly responsible for the great, you know, the lion's share of whatever the medical costs were going to be. So that's one of the things that we can thank RAND for. Your deductible, your medical deductible, straight out of a RAND experiment. If nobody opposes them, they'll go ahead and say, well, let's impose it. That's why I always say, it's an informed public. It's the American people that can stop this. The American people are an ethical people. They're patriotic people. They know what's right, and they know what's wrong. And they know what works, and they know what doesn't. And unless we speak up, these things will happen. And people will come up with this cockamamie plans, with these weird things whereby they expect us to pull the money out of our pockets and pay for something that we don't have to, because we don't speak up, because we don't say, no, that's not the way it's going to be. We think different. Unless we speak up, this will continue to happen. The price of freedom is eternal vigilance.